How are y'all doing this morning? Is it good to be in the house of the Lord? We had Sunday school today, y'all. This is awesome. Getting back to some kind of normalcy here. We're loving this. And, you know, obviously want you to continue to use good judgment and, you know, don't be hugging up on everybody yet. I mean, we still want to continue to do what we do. But praise to God that we are back functioning in Sunday school and back here today, and what a joy it is to be here. And I just want to welcome you today, especially any guests that we have. We're so glad to have you here today. And just if you received the bulletin, there's a tab in there that you can tear off, and if you would just fill that out so we get a record of you coming and just knowing that you were here worshiping with us today. So right now we're going to ask you to stand up. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to get started worshiping God. So let's pray. Dear Father, Lord, your word tells us that this is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. And Father, we are glad to be here today. We praise you, Father God, for this day and this time. And Father, this is a time where we right now get to experience a worshipful time with you. And Father, I pray right now our hearts and minds are clear. And Father, we are ready to experience you right now. And what you have to say to us through your song and your word. And Father, just give us a great time as we go forward during this service. We love you, Father God, and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm not afraid to die. Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, help but see. Faith. myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, I hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour
Father, we thank you that we can find rest in you, Father, that we can come before a holy and righteous God each and every day, Father, and give our heart and soul to you, Father, and just ask you to guide us each and every day. And dear Lord, we're blessed beyond measure. Sometimes we get caught up in this world and the things that are going wrong, but Father, we can always turn to a God who's right, a God who's just, a God who's holy, a God who is greater than anything we can ever imagine. So, Father, right now, we know it's time for you to speak to us. Father, I pray you speak very loudly and clearly today through Philip. That, Father, the words that you say would resonate with us, Father, and change us, Father. Help us to be better once we hear it than we were before. Father, we love you, we praise you, and we just thank you for this time. Bless Philip as he brings us his message in Jesus' name.
Good morning. What a wonderful time of worship. Amen. Hey, give these guys a hand. Haven't they done such a great job leading us so well? Thank you, guys. Well, if you're glad to be here this morning, say amen. If you're glad school started this week, say hallelujah. Oh, that's better than I thought. Okay. Well, hey, I want to jump right in this morning and talk to you about when you do the right thing the wrong way. When you do the right thing the wrong way. We're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 6. 2 Samuel chapter 6. When you do the right thing the wrong way. Does that mean anything to anybody? Does that resonate with anybody? Listen, students, if you cheat, you may get the right answer, but you've done it the wrong way. Right? If you are married or if you have children, then you definitely know that there is a wrong way to do the right thing. Let me give you an example. If you have the intentions of helping your wife, let's say you want to help her put up the groceries. They're sitting on the table, and that's a good thing to do. That's the right thing to do. Until you put the ranch on the wrong shelf. Amen. Did you know that there is a specific spot for the mustard? I find this out quite often. Or you may be trying to give your child advice or direction or correction, and that is certainly the right thing to do. But once a child hits a certain age, like 2, there is a wrong way to do it, and most likely whatever way you're doing it is wrong. Amen. And hey, by the way, for you parents with younger children, that doesn't change until they hit their mid-20s. Okay. Just FYI. So we know that there is a wrong way to do the right thing. 2 Samuel chapter 6, we're going to look at the entire chapter, and you say, whoa, that's a lot of scripture. Well, some of us need a lot of work. Amen. Hey, look at the person next to you and say, he's talking about you. Just kidding. I was talking to them. 2 Samuel chapter 6. Let's pray as we dive into God's word this morning. Father, we love you. We thank you for today. God, we thank you for the opportunity to come, to worship, to learn, to dive into your word. And Father, may you speak truth over us this morning. God, if there's one here that doesn't know you, may today be the day of salvation. God, may you increase, may I decrease, and you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. 2 Samuel chapter 6, starting in verse 1, it says, David again brought together out of Israel chosen men, 30,000 in all. He and all his men set out from Bala of Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord Almighty, who is enthroned between the cherubim that are on the ark. Now, I want to give you a crash course, just a lot of quick information about the ark. You may not know what the ark is, and it's very important that you know what the ark is. It's also called the Ark of the Covenant, if that sounds familiar to you. The ark was a box or a chest. It was actually made about 400 years prior to this scripture taking place in 2 Samuel chapter 6 by Moses. The ark was made of wood. It was covered by gold with an ornate gold lid, often referred to as the mercy seat. It measured 3 feet 9 inches long, 2 feet 3 inches wide, and 2 feet 3 inches high. Inside the Ark of the Covenant was the tablets of the law that Moses brought down from Mount Sinai, a jar of manna, and Aaron's rod that miraculously budded as a confirmation of his leadership. The last mention of the ark was back in 1 Samuel chapter 7 when it was retrieved from the Philistines. The Philistines had actually captured or taken possession of the ark, and they took it back to their land. And so the Israelites went to get it, and it's been at the house of this guy named Abinadab for about 20 years. And because the ark was at the house of Abinadab, God had been blessing Abinadab and his entire household. The ark of God represented the immediate presence and the glory of God himself in Israel. And so David, he saw that the way God was blessing the house of Abinadab, and David wanted that blessing for Israel. He wanted the presence of God and the glory of God to be back in Jerusalem, because he wanted the blessings of God to be on and to be over the entire nation and not just one house. And so this was so important to David that he gathers his best men to go and get the ark, 30,000 men in all. Verse 3, they set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it from the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. And I want to pause right there. They set the ark of God on a new cart. Because that may sound good, like they were taking precautions. We're gonna set this thing on a cart, and we're going to take it back to Jerusalem. Hey, we need a new cart, not just any cart. We need a new cart to haul this thing. If we get a new cart, man, that will really impress and please the Lord. It goes on to say in that verse, Uzzah and Ahio, sons of Abinadab, were guiding the new cart. Okay? Uzzah was the son of Abinadab, and he has this idea of transporting the ark on a cart. Now, where did he get that idea from? That's the way that the Philistines transported the ark. But guess what? They ain't Philistines. They are followers of the one true God. And for you and me, that means that they are set apart. And so that goes for us as well. We don't do what everyone else is doing just because they're doing it. We don't watch stuff because everybody else is watching it. We don't listen to stuff because everybody else is listening. We don't do what is popular. We don't go to places that everybody else goes to. We don't follow the trends. We follow Jesus. We're supposed to be different. Not better, just different. There has got to be something about you and about me that lets everybody around us know that we are different. Amen? And if we're doing a better job of fitting in rather than standing out, if we're following the crowds, if we're not any different, then there's a problem. There's a disconnect between us and God. And according to Exodus 25, 12 through 15, the ark was designed to be carried, always carried, with two poles. The ark had these rings at the corners, and you slid these poles into the rings, and it was to be carried always by four dudes. And putting it on a cart, whether the cart was old or new, was against the specific command of God. The right thing, the wrong way. And not only was it supposed to be carried, according to Numbers 4:15, it was only to be carried by the Levites from a certain family. So you can see that this is probably not going to go well. I wonder how many times we go against the Word of God, the will of God, the instructions of God, even if we're trying to do the right thing. And God is just like, I can't believe what he's doing. I can't believe what I'm seeing. But because he is gracious and merciful, he doesn't give us what we deserve. But sooner or later, you got to wonder, when is enough enough? Think about that new cart for a moment. I believe that we have tried to turn the gospel into something that it is not. When I say we, I mean people in general, pastors, preachers, teachers of the Bible, and we tried to turn the gospel and the Word of God into something new, something it was never intended to be. And there are churches and there are teachers and preachers who say, well, if you don't like this part of it, that's fine. We'll just kind of leave it out. You just keep coming. If you don't like that part of it, that's fine. We'll change it a little bit. We'll twist it a little bit. We'll turn it just a little bit until it sounds agreeable to you. You just keep coming. Keep giving your money. We'll admit it. We'll delete it. We'll change it. We'll twist it until it fits for you. And we've taken the gospel and we've turned it into something that goes against the specific commands of God. From the first word to Genesis, to the final word in Revelation, and every word in between is inherent, infallible, God-breathed, God-inspired word of God. Revelation 22, 18 and 19 tells us this: I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book, if anyone adds anything to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. And if anyone takes words away from this book of prophecy, God will take away from him his share in the tree of life and in the holy city, which are described in this book. You think God is serious about his word? He is. And so, listen, I think that the method that we deliver the gospel can change. I think as culture changes, we have to be ready and willing to adapt. I love the fact that when all this first started going down, that we could meet face-to-face virtually with Zoom meetings. I love that I could deliver a message to our students from my kitchen. So we have to adapt. We have to be able to come up with new ways to deliver the message, but the message itself never changes. We don't need a new cart. We need a fresh fire. We need a fresh fire. We need a renewed passion for Jesus. So if it's not pointing to the glory of God and lifting up the name of Jesus, then it's disrespectful to God. And when we turn the gospel into something it is not, God notices. Look back to verse 3. They set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it from the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, sons of Abinadab, were guiding the new cart with the ark of God on it, and Ahio was walking in front of it. So they've got their new cart. Abinadab's sons were out front leading the way. They've seen the blessings of God. They've been in the presence and the glory of God for the past 20 years. But instead of following the instructions of God, they've decided to drive this cart their way. Verse 5. David and the whole house of Israel were celebrating with all their might before the Lord, with songs and with harps, lyres, tambourines, sistrums, and cymbals. Imagine the celebration that's taking place. And don't get me wrong, this was cause for celebration. They are returning the presence of God and the glory of God to Jerusalem. It is cause for a celebration. They're singing, they're dancing, they're worshiping, jumping, running all over the place. They got their fancy new cart, and I know that David's heart is in the right place. That's not even a question for me. But it was the right thing the wrong way. And I compare what was taking place here to the almost theatrical production that some churches put on today. We judge a worship experience based on how it makes us feel. And the only thing that really matters is that we've come to worship the Lord. That's it. Anything other than that, and we've come in vain. But I believe that some people think, well, they did the songs that I really like today, so man, it's going to be really easy for me to worship. I can get in this service today, man. Or they did songs that I didn't like. I couldn't follow. I couldn't sing, so, man, I can't worship like this. Or we sit there and we think, and I really didn't get anything from that preacher today, so I'm just going to scroll and hope nobody notices. And listen, I need you to know that I'm preaching to myself. Sometimes my heart's not in the right place. So I'm preaching to myself. I'm just glad you're in the room. It's not about what pleases us. It's about what pleases God. It's not about what we get out of it. It's about what we give. It's about what we bring. Verse 6 goes on to say, when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah reached out and took hold of the ark of God because the oxen stumbled. So get this picture. They're rolling along. They've got the ark on a new cart. Everything is good. The musicians are playing. The dancers are dancing. And all of a sudden, the ox hits a bump or stumbles over a hole and the cart shakes. And the ark must have looked like it was about to come off the cart because Uzzah reaches out his hand. By the way, that never would have happened if they were transporting the ark according to instructions in the Word of God. But Uzzah, probably out of pure instinct, we probably all done it. We see something about to fall and we try to brace it. And so Uzzah sticks out his hand to make sure that the ark doesn't fall off the cart, and this is what happens next in verse 7. The Lord's anger burned against Uzzah because of this irreverent act. Therefore, God struck him down, and he died there beside the ark of God. And we hear that, and man, it seems so harsh, like, whoa, God, that's really aggressive. Like maybe God has anger issues or something. But the reality is that this is just the tip of the iceberg with this guy, Uzzah. There's a lot of stuff going on in his life that we don't know about. Listen, Uzzah had been taking care of the ark at his house for the last few decades. He knew that once those poles were inserted in the ark to carry it, they were not supposed to be removed. He knew that the ark was not to be touched by human hands. Now, I don't know if because the ark had been at his house for so long that he just dropped his guard about the way to care for it or just totally disregarded the instructions of the Lord. But either way, he was very casual with the way that he handled the ark. Eugene Peterson wrote a biography on the life of David, and this is what he said about Uzzah. Uzzah is the person who has God in a box and assumes responsibility for keeping God safe from the mud and dust of the world. Men and women keep showing up who take it upon themselves to protect God from the vulgarity of sinners and the ignorance of common people. His death wasn't sudden. It was years in the making. And I believe that when Uzzah reached out his hand to steady the ark, it was symbolic of the religious mindset and philosophy that he had adopted. And listen, if we're honest with ourselves, it's the same mindset that many church people have adopted today. So when Uzzah reached out his hand, it was him saying, "Don't worry, God, I got you. I got you, God. I don't need to obey how you've told me to approach you. I don't need to obey how you told me to approach the things that you've called me to do. I've brought you along for the journey. I even have this nice new car for you to ride on." And so it's like you and me saying, okay God, I'm here. I've set aside this time for you. Aren't you pleased? Let's make it good. Listen, you don't need a God you've got to hold up. You need a God that can hold you up. You don't need a God you have to catch. You need a God that can catch you. Amen? I heard a pastor say this one time, a religion you can control has no power to save your soul. And I believe that the people of God, in general, we have put God in a box, and we've become very casual and in some ways irreverent in the way that we handle worship, the Word of God, the instructions of the Lord, prayer, church attendance, morality, and we could go on and on and on. We have become careless while still professing Christ in the same breath. And when we are casual with the things of God, there are consequences. It says the Lord was angry with this irreverent act. I don't believe that God is constantly, you know, watching us, waiting for us to mess up so he can take us out. But I wonder how many times our irreverence stirs up the anger of God, but Jesus steps in and says, "I've already paid for that." And from his casual attitude in this irreverent act, the Lord took Uzzah out and struck him dead. Verse 8, then David was angry because the Lord's wrath had broken out against Uzzah, and to this day that place is called Perez Uzzah. David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, "How can the ark of the Lord ever come to me?" David was angry. He was confused. He was afraid. If you've ever felt this way when it comes to God, if you've ever been angry with God, if you've ever been confused with the will of God, the plan for your life, or wondered, you know, what else do I have to do? It's okay. David felt that way too. And see, he thought he was doing everything right, but our intentions are never enough. God cares not only about our hearts, but also our actions. So even when we do the right thing the wrong way, there can be devastating consequences. So David doesn't think that he can bring the ark back to Jerusalem. Verse 10, he was not willing to take the ark of the Lord to be with him in the city of David. Instead, he took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. The ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite for 3 months, and the Lord blessed him and his entire household. Now, this is not a humorous situation by any means. I just kind of find it funny that David is like, I don't want that thing with me, right? I've seen what happened. If that's what's going to happen to somebody who lets their guard down, or somebody who has a moment of lapse in judgment, then I don't want it near me. Let's drop it off at that guy's house, right? And I can hear the conversation. There's a knock on the door, and David is like, hey, I got the ark of God out here. We're just going to leave it here for a while. Don't call us. We'll call you, right? And he bolts. He takes off. And the truth was that this was not just a random guy. This guy, Obed-Edom, he was a Levite from the family of Kohath. This was the family that was instructed in the Word of God to take care of and care for the ark. So God blesses him and his household. Verse 12. Now, King David was told the Lord had blessed the house of Obed-Edom and everything he has because of the ark of God. So David went down and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. So David gives the report that God has been blessing the house of Obed-Edom for the last 3 months. And David is like, I want to get in on that. Let's try this again. I want to give this another shot. So he goes to get it. You notice there is still rejoicing. David is rejoicing at the news that the ark has been a source of blessing, and he wants in on that blessing. Verse 13, when those who were carrying the ark of the Lord had taken 6 steps, he sacrificed a bull and fattened calf. I believe that David knew that they did not do it right the first time. And so this time he was not taking any chances. He brought Levites to carry the ark. They put the ark on their shoulders with the poles, as the instructions say to do, and they took 6 steps. Everybody say 6 steps. And they stopped for a sacrifice. David wasn't going to take any chances this time. This was elaborate. You might think it was excessive. You might think it was over the top, but it was done in a way that glorified the Lord. And I believe that David thought, oh, you thought last time was a production. You ain't seen nothing yet. Hold my ark. And so the sacrifice they stopped to make was not just a random sacrifice. There are many offerings referred to in the Old Testament, and this one that they stopped on the 6th step to take was a burnt offering. And the significance here of the burnt offering was that before the sacrifice took place, hands were placed on the head of the animal to transfer any sin that was present to the animal before the sacrifice, ceremonially speaking, of course. And so they all placed their hands on this animal before they sacrificed it and offered it up as a sacrifice to the Lord. And so this animal that was sacrificed in this burnt offering that day was a substitute for the sins of the people before they went any further with the ark. It's a picture of the cross. The whole system of burnt offerings is pointing to Christ. It's pointing to Jesus taking our place, hanging on a cross with our sins transferred onto the Savior of the world. So what David is saying is, yes, God, Uzzah's heart was not right, but ultimately, God, I am responsible. I take the responsibility. And before we go a step further, accept this offering and forgive our sins. And the fact that David stopped on the 6th step is also significant. 7 in the Bible represents completion. It represents wholeness. And so David was saying by stopping on the 6th step is that there can be no completion. There can be no wholeness without forgiveness. We cannot accomplish anything without the power of God. If not for the blood of Jesus, then none of us have the opportunity at a right relationship with God. It's not about us being good enough or loading God up on our fancy new card and taking him to Sunday services. It's not about checking boxes so that God will eventually say, wow, look at this guy. Look how awesome he is. It's all about Jesus and the blood that was spilt and the sacrifice he made. And only from that do we even have a chance at a right relationship with God and being complete in him. So David stops on the sixth step, and he offers a sacrifice. And only when the sacrifice was made and the seventh step was taken, the music and dancing was able to continue. Verse 14. David, wearing a linen ephod, danced before the Lord with all his might, while he and the entire house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts and the sound of trumpets. So David obviously is Pentecostal. Amen. Any Pentecostal people here? He has no problem with singing and dancing when he is expressing his emotions to God. Listen, he had an emotional connection with God. But that's where we have to be careful, because we can go too far one way or the other when it comes to emotions in our journey with Jesus. And you've probably seen both. You've probably seen the person that gets carried away and jumps up and runs around the sanctuary or starts speaking some unintelligible words because they think they're speaking in tongues. But I know you've probably seen it the other way also. The person who refuses to give in to the movement of the Holy Spirit in any way. They won't sing. They won't worship. They barely move. And the Spirit of God is moving. And sometimes I just want to stick a mirror under their nose to see if they're alive. See, our emotions shouldn't be manipulated when it comes to our worship, but they shouldn't be repressed either. Be who you are when it comes to the movement of the Holy Spirit and respond the way that God is calling you to. That's nothing more, nothing less. That's what God wants. And so David is getting his praise on, and he realizes that he is wearing royal garments. And with all that has just taken place, the sacrifice, the burnt offering, the blood of the sacrifice, all pointing towards Christ, the ultimate sacrifice, David can't help but dance. The glory of God is returning to Israel, and David gets caught up in the moment. He gets caught up in the music. He gets caught up in the rhythm. Listen, it's just like Gloria Estefan said in the 80s, the rhythm is going to get you. Sorry. And he didn't just dance. The Bible says he danced with all his might. Look at verse 16. As the ark, y'all are singing that song in your head now, aren't you? Verse 16, as the ark of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. And when she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. Why did David's wife despise him when she saw him dancing? Well, first of all, let's clarify, David was not in his whitey tighties. Okay, he's not dancing around in his drawers, so that's not an issue. That's not a reason for her to be mad. The linen ephod that he was wearing, his outer garments would have been this ornate kingly robe that would have let you know without a doubt that this was a king, okay? And so underneath would have just been a simple tunic that the average person might wear. So let me break it down a little bit more. He took off a tuxedo, and he put on jeans and a t-shirt. So now he's just one of the guys worshiping the king. And a lot of times we hate or we don't understand or we don't like what we don't understand, right? You see that so often in today's society. You cannot have a conversation with someone who thinks or believes differently than you do without it turning ugly. So maybe David's wife didn't worship God the way that she did. Maybe she didn't worship God at all, or maybe it was as simple as she didn't think a king should behave in such a way. But I'll tell you this, as long as you live for the Lord, As long as you profess Jesus with your actions and with your words, there will always be those who don't understand what you're doing and why you're doing it. And there are some who will actually look out their window of superiority down on you. I receive that as a badge of honor. Verse 17. They brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it, and David sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. After he had finished sacrificing the burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord Almighty. And then he gave a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins to each person. And the whole crowd of the Israelites, both men and women, and all the people went to their homes. So now the ark is back where it's supposed to be. It's back in Jerusalem. And the people celebrate. They celebrate by worshiping. They celebrate by partying. Sounds like they have a huge, you know, family reunion style barbecue going on. Doesn't sound like they were social distancing, but they are giving it all they've got. Verse 20 goes on to say, when David returned home to bless his household, Michal, daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, how the king of Israel has distinguished himself today, disrobing in sight of the slave girls of his servants as any vulgar fellow would do. So David has just achieved this, you know, great monumental achievement and event for the nation of Israel. He's pumped. He's excited. He's been singing. He's been dancing. He's been worshiping. And he walks through the door to biting sarcasm. Did you know that you have the power with your words alone to build someone up or to tear them down? And sometimes it's not even what you say, it's how you say it. Have you ever heard that? Even the look on your face speaks volumes. And rather than be present at the celebration, Michal was just content to watch everything from her window and then be her husband's biggest critic. Sometimes your biggest critic will be someone who wasn't even present when the work was being done. But I want to challenge you, be an encourager. There is power in your words, and it needs to start in the home. Listen, y'all, if it ain't working in the home, it ain't going to work anywhere. Amen? It matters how you talk to your kids, and I'm not against discipline. Please don't misunderstand. It matters how you speak to your spouse. It matters how you treat your parents. Amen? It matters. God sees that. But here's the deal. Three times in this chapter, Michal is referred to not as the wife of David, but as the daughter of Saul. And that's done with a purpose. It lets us know that this is the lens that Michal is seeing the events that are taking place. So her identity in this chapter is the daughter of Saul. So the reason for her sarcasm is because her father never would have done a thing like this. But what's really at the heart of the matter is that she is Uzzah 2.0. See, religion is the best that she could do. It's the best that she could offer. She didn't mind the ark coming back. She didn't mind God showing up. But she would have much rather preferred that it came back on a cart with David walking, not taking his robe off, not singing, not dancing. I don't mind a little bit of God on Christmas and Easter, but let's not get carried away, okay? And there are people who think that. The blood, the sacrifice, that's a little much, don't you think? But without the blood, there's no atonement for my sin or for your sin. Verse 21, we'll close this thing up. David said to Michal, it was before the Lord who chose me rather than your father or anyone from his house when he appointed me ruler over the Lord's people Israel, and I will celebrate before the Lord. I will become even more undignified than this, and I will be humiliated in my own eyes, but by these slave girls you spoke of, I will be held in honor. And Mikhail, daughter of Saul, had no children to the day of her death. Now, I'm not saying that you should respond to sarcasm with sarcasm, okay? That never works. Lord knows I need to work on that one, amen. But I love the fact that David did not let his wife's words ruin this day. And he responds by reminding her, hey, you just mad because God chose me and not your daddy. It basically is what he says. And for that, I will worship. I did this for the Lord, not for you. And so what he was saying is that the dancing and the singing, it's not for you. It wasn't for the people. I don't care what you think. I don't care what anybody else thinks, because I'm doing this for the Lord. And then this chapter ends by telling us that Mikhail never had any children. It doesn't tell us that she was barren or that she was unable to have kids or that this was some kind of curse from the Lord. It just could have been the fact that David no longer had anything to do with it. Who knows? But I think it stands to reason that there is barrenness in the life and in the ministry of anyone who is overly critical. Your words matter. So in closing, as our musicians come, I just want to challenge you with a couple of things. When you do the right thing the wrong way, it's possible that no one will ever notice. It could be that there will be little to no consequences. But when you do the right thing the wrong way, the consequences could be devastating, especially when it comes to your relationship with Jesus. Listen, relationship is the right thing. Religion is the wrong way. It doesn't matter what anybody else around you is doing. It doesn't matter how they feel or how they worship or refuse to worship for that matter. You be who God has called you to be. If you raise your hands, awesome. If you want to come down to the altar, you do that. Do what God is calling you to do. It shouldn't matter what the person behind you is thinking or what the girl you graduated with high school across the room is thinking. You be who God has called you to be. You may be here this morning and listen, you're pressing forward in your relationship with Jesus. You're taking steps. And maybe you've made mistakes like David. Aren't you glad that failure is not final? God can take your mess and make it your message. He can take your broken pieces and make masterpieces. So maybe you want to come to the altar today before you take that next step. Maybe you want to come and get some things right. Altar is open. Let's stand as we pray. If you're here this morning and you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, you can do that today. Maybe you've put God on a cart or in a box and you've tried religion. Religion does not satisfy. Jesus always does. Charlie will be down front. We would love to tell you how you can be saved and have a relationship with Jesus this morning. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Lord, may we respond now as your word has been declared and proclaimed. Father, may we respond accordingly. Nothing more, nothing less, God. May we come to the altar if that's what you're calling us to do, or stand in place. Pray, worship, sing, rejoice, give thanks. Whatever it is, Lord, I pray that every person in this room will respond the way that you're calling us to in this moment. Or if there's one here today that's not saved, Father, I pray that you would not let them leave this place until they get that right with you. Or don't let us take another step until it's right. We love you, we praise you, we give you this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just as I am without one plea, but that
bowed, please, for a moment. We are here today, gathered to worship. God is moving in hearts. Pray for your neighbor. They present themselves to the Lord as they are, willing to be different the days ahead. And pray for yourself that you say that same prayer. You do things God's way, not just your way, even if you're doing the right thing. Remind all of us that Jesus is the reason we have salvation. He is the hope for our nation. Hope for you, for me, for our families. May we continue to seek to please Him, doing things His way in all that we do. Please keep praying. You may open your eyes. We do not ever want to stop the service till God is finished. Amen. So we pray He continues to work in your life even as you leave. There's some information for you. The tab that we have in the bulletin is for guests, but also if you have perhaps changed a phone number or think you have changed a phone number or not sure if you've changed a phone number, since the last time you let us know, would you please just write your name and the new phone number on that, the cell number, put it in the green box as you leave. That certainly does help us out a great deal. Also in the bulletin, you see a survey from the men's ministry. The green box is back there. You may put that information there also if you have any comments about that. So please pray about that, and that box will be back there for a while. Remind you that there's a Vacation Bible School training meeting today at 5 o'clock in the fellowship hall. If you need information about Vacation Bible School, Wendy is there at the back. She would love to register your child, and so you will see her for that. Tonight, our missions organizations will meet back also, so we're moving back toward a regular schedule completely. If you are willing to bring any items for our children's homes, Tuesday will be the collection day. We're putting those in the fellowship hall. We've had some items, but you have till Tuesday to bring those, so please do that. Next Saturday will be our banner drop. It'll be different this time because the stuff is going to come pre-boxed, so it helps us to get things out to the people faster. But if you know somebody who needs food, please remind them to come. And if you want to help, please be here about 8 o'clock that day. That will take care of that. Also remind you that we have a church box back there with a hole in it for your tithe. We are still trying to keep people from touching as many things as possible for your protection. So if you have a tithe you'd like to leave, put it in that as you leave, or you can do it online. Last but not least, if you want to be a part of the scavenger hunt, Michelle will be back at the back. It's for ladies only. Maybe trying to find out a new person, not a new husband. No, just kidding. Anyway, she'll be back there, and she has requested you see her if you wish to sign up for a team. So all that is back there. So God is all the time and all the time. Alan Short, brother, would you dismiss us today?